We have to call the meeting to order and then motion to approve minutes from March 8th.
Second.
Okay, done. Schedule appointments. I asked the water commissioners to come tonight because water is becoming a big topic around town. And we've got to figure out a way to move forward with water, but also learn from our past, our successes and our failures, and all that kind of stuff. And we're in a situation where we're in pretty good shape with water, and that's why we have these conversations about what's next and to make sure that the future water is protected. But the water's in good shape this year because of work that's been done over the past 40 years. So I wanted the water commissioners to come tonight because I wanted you guys to be aware for the past 40 years or so, and I wish the school people were here as well. We've had a person who has given his blood, sweat, and tears, I don't know, blood, sweat, to the Whately Water Department and to the students of Whately through his representation on the Frontier School Committee. And because our water is in such good shape, and because we've had such a dedicated person in Bill Smith, I decided this year to dedicate this year's annual report to Bill Smith. And that's really the only reason you guys are here. We don't have any check. So, Bill, from the deepest bottom of my heart, I want to thank you for all you've done for the town since the 70s. I'm hoping that factually everything that's written in the annual report is, for the most part, factual.
My parents always told me, if you're going to lie, don't put it in print.
I know. Well, not so much lie, but just, you know, misinformation. But no. In all seriousness, you've been a critical part of the success of this town, and I can't think of another person, because you opted to retire. Other reasons too. I couldn't think of a person I'd rather dedicate this, on behalf of the select board, dedicate this annual report to. So. Is this Bill's copy, or is he going to?
Is this next year, Tommy?
Yeah, I guess. If I go.
All right, I'll read it. I'll read what I said. And there's a phenomenal picture of you in here.
School committee.
All right. It really hasn't changed that dramatic. This one is a little more Goose Gossage mustache than the one you have now. You know Goose Gossage.
I absolutely.
Yeah. All right. Dedications are funny things. Sometimes it seems fitting to dedicate the annual report to someone who had a good year, just like you give an MVP to a ballplayer who wins a triple crown. Other years it seems more appropriate to dedicate the annual report because of a lifetime achievement to Whately, in the same way that George Harrison gets a lifetime achievement award for music. For Whately in 2015, you are struck by changes in personnel that make you think about what Whately would have been like, or different, had this year's honoree never built his life in Whately. Just like if George Harrison had decided never to pick up a bass guitar. Earlier in 2015, when Bill Smith announced his retirement as Whately Water Superintendent, a person couldn't help but wonder what Whately would be like if Bill had made another Western Massachusetts community his home. It truly might be a very different town than it is today. And because of the lifetime contribution he's made to Whately, we dedicate this year's annual report to Bill Smith. In 1976, a recent graduate from Frontier Regional High School named Bill Smith was elected to the Whately School Committee. Since that time, while dozens of other names have come and gone, Bill Smith has been a constant, from working to build support for high school building renovations in the late 80s to the mascot controversy in the mid to late 90s. Bill Smith was dedicated to ensuring that Whately children receive the best possible education. Bill is always Frontier's biggest advocate across town, and families have always known he is in their corner, in their educational corner. Up until late 2015, Bill also served as the first and only Whately Water Superintendent, creating a town water department out of the challenges and concern born from the Whately water contamination crisis of 1987. Since then, Bill has worked with water commissioners and residents to make sure that all Whately residents on the town's water supply have safe drinking water that can be relied upon. As someone who has worked with Bill for 12 years on town water issues, the achievements he has realized in this role are no small feat. Between education and water, along with stints on the Whately Police and Fire Departments, Bill has been a staple of dedication to Whately. As he begins his well-earned retirement in 2016 as Whately Water Superintendent, it does not diminish his commitment and hard work on behalf of Whately. While he still serves on the school committee, we believe now it is fitting time to honor his service to the town. There is no question that Whately is a better place because of Bill's lifetime achievements in Whately. And for his service to the town, we proudly dedicate this annual report to the name of Bill Smith, respectfully submitted, Jonathan Edwards, Chair.
I'd like to second Jonathan's congratulations to Bill on the town report. Because I've known Bill for probably over 50 years. 60 years, going back years, and we were working on a farm and all, and he's one of the few people that have stayed in town and helped the town prosper and develop, especially the water system. And I know I've relied on Bill and asked questions since we've been back here in the last 6-7 years. He's always been responsive, answering questions, stopping in, see how things are going. If I had an issue, he would always be there. So appreciate your timeliness and dedication to the water department and to the town of Whately.
Yeah.
No, I'm speechless. And everybody knows that's a rare. And you guys got me with this one.
Yeah, hopefully it's a theme that'll continue through, you know, town meeting. No. but Bill, well deserved. So thank you.
Thanks again.
Thank you. Chief.
Yes, sir.
Did water commission want to say anything or no? Are you all set?
We're all set.
You sure? Wayne, you got anything?
Me?
Yeah. No?
Okay. You have bigger shoes than you
have. All right, Chief.
Okay, I'll be brief if you'd like. Just giving a quick update. I've been submitting, usually send a copy to Mark and Paul as well, but what we've been doing is compiling the data from all of the calls for service that we have for Whately. So what you see in the town report as far as statistical data, that information is for more or less the major crimes. So that's not an accurate representation of what we actually do. So what I started doing, I can't remember what it was now. Maybe it was the 1st of July, since we started doing, posting our stats on Facebook, the department's Facebook page. So each month I compile all the stats and I post them on the Facebook page. So just for the purposes of this meeting, January and February, it looks like we're right around. January is 533 calls for service. February is 540. We're up to about 11 arrests now. When we look at incidents, what I post on Facebook as far as incidents, those are actual investigations that we have. So we're looking at about 25 to 30 per month on average that we're getting. Medical calls. We've been doing pretty well, I guess you could say, as far as the community being healthy. We've only had 4 medical calls each month. I think we're probably in line for the same thing for March. We hear the tone going off from the South County EMS, and it's usually Sunderland or Deerfield, so we've been doing pretty well with that. Crashes, motor vehicle crashes have been pretty low. We're looking at about three or four a month. Motor vehicle stops, those usually average anywhere between 40 and 60. motor vehicle stops per month. So just to give you an idea of how the stats look, what I've been posting on Facebook, we've been getting good reports from the community as far as people responding to that, whether they like it on Facebook or whether they give comments. So we're getting positive feedback. far as the stats go. Just a little bit about, since the first of the year, what's been going on for the police department. We're kind of in the middle of our in-service training for the year, which is the mandated 40 hours of training that every officer has to go through every year. So we're kind of in the midst of that. We have, I think in 2 weeks, we're going to be doing CPR first responder for in-service. We've done fair and impartial policing. There was a big push for that this year with everything that's been going on nationwide. To kind of giving a fresh look at policing and a fresh look at use of force. That's kind of where our training has gone this year. So looking at use of force and that fair and impartial policing to try to get that stigma out of there of all police departments are just beating people up and we're not fair and impartial. So we're all undergoing training for that. In addition to that, the firearms training, defensive tactics training as well. Community-wise, I've done a couple of firearm safety courses since the first of the year. We're in the process. I'm working with Don right now. He's last year became certified as a CPR first responder instructor. So that's CPR first responder for police and fire. There's also a component to that, which is just basic CPR and first aid. So we're in the process of working out something where we can start offering classes to the community for people that want to learn CPR or first aid. So we're going to be rolling that out soon, hopefully. Just a couple of things that have been going on, the things that people are concerned about, the scams. We're seeing scams, fraudulent stuff. That's kind of where things are going. People stealing other people's identities and using credit cards. We had an incident at our local Bank of the Box, our ATM machine, where somebody put a scanner or a skimmer on the machine, so it was collecting data from people's cards. We also recovered a camera from that machine. Fortunately, from what we can gather, working with the banks, and there's a task force that's actually part of this as well, it doesn't look like anybody's identity was compromised based on what they got from the machine in Whately. There was no wireless transmission or anything, so it looks like we have the data that they skimmed, so we took custody of that. So none of that information got out there. There was no fraudulent activity on anybody's accounts that had gone to the bank while the skimmer was on.
Did you catch the people or person that was involved?
We have a photo of the person that put it on there. We have video and photo of the person that put it on there. There's also other photo and video from other banks in Western Mass, which we believe is the same individual. We haven't been able to identify him yet, but that's kind of what the task force is working on right now. We've got a whole packet of individuals that have been doing this kind of thing.
Is that picture on your Facebook page, or can it be? Just in case people in the community.
We talked about that, and I think the last thing that I heard, and this is about 3 weeks ago, the last thing I heard from the task force was to hold off on releasing any public identity information, that kind of stuff, so they could kind of follow up. Because just Bank of America alone, they deal with about 600 of these a year. That's just Bank of America. So this is a bigger than just Whately.
They got more money than Whately does to spend on them.
Yeah, I'm running investigations. So that's a big thing, that, and like I said, the fraudulent stuff. People getting people's identities and using it online to purchase things, using credit cards, that kind of thing. So we're starting to see an uptick in those kind of crimes. That's pretty much it. I just wanted to express, I know I get a lot of our guys come to us, or come to me, in reference to Southtown EMS. I know that's kind of a hot topic locally lately, but I just wanted to point out the support from our department for Southtown EMS was, since their inception. I mean, they've done a great job. They actually beat us to call sometimes, which hasn't happened. I've been here since 2000. It hasn't happened since 2000, and that's the fact that it's happening frequently. I mean, they're average seven minute response time. Sometimes we're 10 minutes away, and they're getting there before us. So I know my guys appreciate it. I appreciate it. The job that they do, nothing but professional, and but you know, they have our support.
Great.
So, unless you guys have any questions, that's kind of a quick rundown from the first of the year.
On your Facebook site, I guess I'll admit I've never been on it. What's the address, and could you tell people what's on there for them to look at?
Well, the Facebook we use is kind of the community outreach. We put that out there for we put pictures of people that we're trying to identify. We put information on scams that come up. We put public information thing. We put the stats, the monthly stats, anything of importance that's really going on that we want to get out to the community. And we use it as an avenue to communicate with the community, because a lot of times they don't come to the police station to talk to us in person, but they'll send us messages on Facebook. So we'll get information from people that'll just send it to us, and they want to remain anonymous, but they just want to give us the information. So they'll post it on the public Facebook, but they'll send us a message. So a lot of things like that. I mean, we try to put some pictures up there, things that happen around Whately, things that we see or our officers see, you know, if there's a major storm or there's something going on that we feel that people may be interested in, just to draw the attention. I think we're, right now for Whately, I think we have more, I want to say it's around 1,300 or 1,400 people that are following us on Facebook, so that's almost our population. I know not every single one of them is a Whately resident, but I think that's pretty good for a small town. And each day I look and there's more, two or three more likes on there. So the Facebook page is the facebook.com/Whately Police Department. So anybody can go on there and again use that as an avenue to communicate with us.
Okay, I noticed in the area, I guess other police agencies are getting cameras, and also the other big thing for a while has been Narcan for the opiate stuff. Are you trained or have that, or what's the status for Whately for that?
We, as far as the Narcan goes, we don't. Both Don and I are both certified instructors for the Narcan. Don did it as part of the CPR first responder training. So we haven't rolled it out yet. There's really no real justification. I mean, it's the finances behind it. That's kind of the issue. Not that we have a huge heroin problem within our community. I think this year, it wasn't confirmed heroin, but we had one report of an overdose. Last year, I think we had three or four, but either way, you could look at it as an epidemic if you want to. I know it's a problem locally. I haven't had a huge push for it, just because the response that our ambulance has had, it's been so quick that it's not like we're going to be there with somebody for 10 minutes before the ambulance gets there. We haven't run into those situations. They're so quick behind us that we haven't really had to push for it so much as far as the Narcan goes. And
the cameras,
body cameras, it's a huge topic for discussion all across Massachusetts. The problem with Massachusetts is the legality behind it, the privacy issues. Those are the things that we're running into as far as problems. I know there's a couple of departments that are trying them out, kind of test process to see how it works out. I know there's been some some recent case law where they've allowed video to come in for certain instances, but when we go to medical calls, when we go into people's houses, you know, if we're putting ourselves on camera, then we're also putting them on camera, because that in turn becomes public information. So the privacy issues is where the big holdup has been. In Massachusetts, the big holdup hasn't been excessive police use of force types of situations. As far as Massachusetts go, compared to the nation, we're really low as far as that goes, as far as excessive force. So I think more of our concern is going towards the privacy of the community and the citizens, because again, that becomes public information. So it's something we're watching. It's expensive. That's probably the biggest holdup, especially for the small departments. There is some grant money that's supposed to be coming out that could be applied towards that, but we're looking at purchasing cameras, anywhere between $500 and $1,000, purchasing the cameras, purchasing software and hardware to store the data. I mean, 540 calls on average per month. It's gonna be 540 recordings per month that we're gonna have to store on our, you know, whether we have to get a server, whether we get a computer, however it's gonna work.
Put it on the cloud.
Yeah.
Put it on the cloud. That's not terribly expensive.
It's not, but there's a lot of security issues that go along with that as well. It's not just password protection, there's encryption, there's all kinds of...
Yeah, I'm just saying that that's what clouds are set up for.
Yeah.
Did any surrounding communities or state police around here use cameras?
The only ones that I know of, let's see, Gill, I think they tried using a camera for a couple of months. I'm not sure if they're still using it. Irving, I know, has rolled out a plan where they're actually using the cameras on a regular basis. I don't know of too many other ones. State police, they're not using the cameras. And Irving, and it's a training thing, and it's an adaptation, if you will, to try to remember, because you physically have to turn the camera on and notify the people that they're being video and audio recorded, that kind of thing. So there's a lot of issues that are coming up with that too, that if you get out of the car quick, you forget to turn it on, are we trying to hide something, or so there's a lot of issues that have to be worked out, a lot of wrinkles that, and that's why some towns are, I think Montague may be starting, I can't remember reading somewhere that Montague may be getting some cameras as well, but it's, when they are used, it's kind of a limited rollout, it's kind of a trial type of thing to see how it goes. And I know the departments that I know that have used it, those are the concerns that they've expressed. It's like, okay, we now have video recording of a medical call that's protected, it's people's privacy, so what do we do with that? Do we throw that out? What if something happens later? If we store it, now it's public information, so we're waiting to kind of see the case law that comes down, or the laws, the legislation that comes down to help protect people's privacy. So. But it's not widespread.
I appreciate the report. I don't have anything specifically to ask, so it sounds like everything's going well.
So far, so good.
So, okay. All right. Thank you. Appreciate it. We'll see you in a month.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah. Very monthly thing. Thank you.
Okay. Public comment?
Just give you guys an update in case you're not aware, so you don't get blindsided tomorrow. SCEMS Board of Oversight has voted to put out an RFP for housing. They were looking at a turnkey operation to see if somebody will build them a building or modify a building fully outfitted. So just so you don't get blindsided tomorrow, in case you hadn't heard that.
Yeah. They're doing the due diligence that some people would like to see them do, and it probably makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll certainly respond to that RFP. And I don't see any reason why we wouldn't be far and away the leading bidder on that RFP from a cost perspective and from a turnkey perspective. That would be my two cents on that.
Mm-hmm. It'll be interesting.
Who's funding this? The SCEMS themselves on their own budget, or?
The RFP?
RFP?
It's coming, I imagine it's coming through their fiscal aid.
Okay.
Yeah. I would be shocked if they get many responses, period. And the responses that they're going to get are going to be a lot more expensive than the one that we could provide. That's my guess.
Yeah, I don't truly don't know. Yeah.
This will be done by time meeting?
No. It looks like everything's being postponed for town meetings.
Well,
that's my impression.
My hope is that this town continues to move forward as if SCEMS is going to be moving into this town. And I think we should take a leadership role in that to demonstrate that there is no better place for SCEMS to go than right here in this building from a public safety perspective. And
you talked about an article of some sort?
No, an article on, well, whether it's an article or some other step that the board could take on its own without necessarily having to go to town meeting, that's up in the air right now in terms of what we need to do. And Mark may have more insight into that when we get to that piece in the thing. But it's my hope that we take a leadership role and say this is where it should go, and anyone who says otherwise doesn't have a firm grasp on what SCEMS has accomplished over the past year and a half and what it can accomplish in a facility like this when all three ambulances are in the same place, when the costs are dramatically lower than they currently are, having the ambulances strewn up around three different locations, on all the stuff we've talked about in the past. So it's my plan to move forward, and I'm hoping and assuming these guys will be all for that, but we haven't talked about it, obviously. But I appreciate that, Dan. Mark, are you?
Can we just move up a few items here? You have some people in the audience. That,
sure.
Start with fire truck Jeep.
You know, our fire truck purchasing committee is under contract with KME to build a providing fire truck for $395,000. Town meeting, finance committee appropriated $400,000 for this truck.
You got that?
I do. This truck is, from day one, we bargained down, we bargained a lot of extra stuff on this truck to get. But we're replacing a 40-year-old truck, and now the new truck has cross lays, trash lines. We have no hose to put on it, so we're gonna have to buy hose. We're gonna have to transfer over radios, and we'd like for this board to approve the $400,000 loan when they go forward with that.
Really looking for is the gap between the cost of the
truck. Yeah, the $5,000. Actually, $5,000.
The gap between what was appropriated and what was.
And what down the bottom, you got quotes for the hose that I plan to put on it and the radio transfers.
Yeah, the fiscal 16 budget?
No. $400,000 was appropriated for the cost of the truck. The total cost ended up being $395,000. Right. So what he's asking for is the balance, that $5,000, to fund.
By hose and nozzles, right. Transfer the radio.
So it's not additional?
No, it's nope. Cash.
Nope.
It's
nope.
Right.
Nope.
No. Right.
That's what in there.
I mean, can you fight a fire without the hoses?
No.
So I would say that's probably a good buy.
It is.
Why I'm not a fireman.
Why would we buy a fire truck without hoses?
What's that?
I know, shame on you. Come on.
Can we buy a fire truck without hoses?
I don't know. You don't buy gas from a car company. You go by a car, it doesn't go to gas, and you got to go somewhere else.
Truth be told, when I bought a new car recently, what was in the tank?
Gas.
Gas.
And it came full, but they had to go buy it from somebody else. I'm guessing that. So.
Yeah, no, I have no problem.
Yeah, no problem. We need a motion to.
Thank you.
Motion.
Second.
Done.
Yeah. Scott was supposed to be coming in. I think I did tell him about 7:30, so we can move on and then circle back.
Scott, that's okay. Oh, Jackson.
Scott Jackson.
Okay.
He wants to talk to you guys about the Forest Legacy.
Okay.
So, do you mind if I jump back up?
You go wherever you want to go.
Okay. Project list. And we did, I'm going to send around an updated project list here. You'll notice at the bottom, we agreed to discuss this periodically, that's why I keep bringing it up.
Yeah.
You'll see some items are crossed out in the high priority section.
Five specifically have been crossed out. And crossed out means they're done.
Well, down below, I've separated them into completed or substantially complete.
Okay.
The reason some are not completed entirely is because they still involve reporting and things like that on my end, but they won't be taking up your time anymore. So. And my guess is that after town meeting, I'd like to have a further discussion on this and maybe move some of those medium priority items up into the high priority.
I guess I'm not sure you need to get our blessing to do that. I mean, if the high priority items are done, it just seems like it's common sense to move to the medium priorities.
Yeah, this is mostly just a check-in. You'll right. see I did add, in parentheses, little updates on some of these items. It's mostly just to keep you guys informed of what the status is on your priority list.
Yeah, we can revisit which ones of these would be replacement parts, but you know, they're all.
Yeah, I'll just keep moving down through the list, but
we can look at it. Can we come back next meeting and look at it?
Yep, I'm just giving you an update.
Okay. So,
does everybody know what this is?
Are there copies of this in the back, just so that people, nope. if they want them?
No, I can make copies.
We'll make copies for everybody who wants to see the list of priorities the town is tackling. Okay. By the way, just for public edification, the five that are either completed or mostly completed, the Mill River construction, cell towers crossed off. We're going to be finishing that up.
So I have a quick update on that.
Okay. The fire truck, as we just heard, town flag is done, and HVAC controls for this building. So we're moving down the list pretty well. What else?
Town administrator updates. Mill River project, I just wanted to let you know that our quarterly report, which is due April 1st, has been filed with NEMA, so we're good on our reporting status. This was our second quarter of reporting. I'm working with NEMA right now to amend the contract because the bills that we're receiving aren't aligning with the actual lines in the grant that were from back 4 years ago when it was originally applied for. So we're amending the contract so that things line up. And as soon as that's complete, which I believe it came in tonight right before the meeting, I'll be able to submit for reimbursement of 75% of what we've expended so far. The last items that need to be completed for that project will be starting in April. It's shrubs, trees, restoration, seed mix, and cleanup, spring cleanup down there. Good on that.
Yeah.
Fire truck, just a quick update on that. The procurement rules and regulations have been reviewed and approved by our attorney, so we're good to go. I did sign the contract. It's been sent back to KME. I'm just waiting to get it back from them. And Lynn is working on the borrowing for that truck right now, and we should have it within 90 days.
And how long a term is it borrowing?
Borrowing it will be 5 years.
5 years.
Town hall window. I don't know if any of you noticed it's been repaired.
Oh, I didn't notice. Okay, good.
Plywood's gone. Nicholas Jones put plexiglass up there, and behind the plexiglass, he pieced together as best he could the old window so that it looks as original as possible. So it's a little more weathertight now. So I just wanted to let you know that has been done. I know that
it
was
looks good. You did a good job.
Yeah,
you
did a great job.
Yeah, everything's got to look better than the plywood.
You wouldn't think it had changed. You did a nice job.
Roof repairs to this building have been completed. The snow and ice guards are on. All the vent pipes that were bent have been repaired and strengthened, actually, so it shouldn't happen again. All the potential leaks have been sealed, and that trim that was damaged from an ice jam a few years ago has been repaired. So just wanted to let you know that work is complete at this time. Town flag, real quickly, Senator Rosenberg's office called here last week and asked if we would be interested in having a flag ceremony at the State House for the town of Whately. I guess it's typical that they have a ceremony and raise the flag officially there with a small ceremony afterwards to, you know, like a reception afterwards, I guess. So I'll get back to you on that. I'm working with their office now to arrange it, but anyone who's interested in attending that is welcome to.
Will we be able to compare schedules, or is it going to be dictated by his schedule and so be it?
I'm
just asking. I get he's busier than we are.
Yeah. I'm not sure yet.
Okay. Just let us know when you're in Boston. We'll set it up.
I'm sure that's what he'd say. Yeah.
I'll get back to you with more information once we get a little closer. The Skims IMA. I'm going to pass around, and we don't need to discuss this because I realize you haven't seen it until now. This is a proposal for some amendments to the IMA. It's my understanding that based on this IMA from 2 years ago, that the select boards can amend this, and we're suggesting maybe that the three select boards get together, make some amendments to this. There is one condition here, though. If you look under Article 5, Section 2, the items that you cannot change are the addition of a member town or the change in location. So I think what the plan would be is to, and again, it's very early on in this, but I think the best steps to take would be to have the three select boards get together to discuss these amendments, vote on them, assuming you all agree with them, and at the annual town meeting have an article on there identical in all three towns, which would request that town meeting voters approve the select boards to make amendments regarding housing so that we don't have to go back before voters once a location is chosen.
Is that the major reason for this, because of housing?
Okay. Yeah. The other thing you'll see in here that is driving it is that Deerfield is asking for an additional vote on the Skims board vote.
Just one vote, though.
Just one vote.
So it'd be 3-2-2.
Not a majority vote, just an additional vote.
So where is this coming from, Deerfield?
This is coming from Deerfield. And again, I know you're just seeing it for the first time, and it's not really on the agenda. I just wanted to hand this out to you so you can read it, and we'll take it up at a meeting.
Now,
is this on for tomorrow's meeting?
It may come up, but it's not part of the agenda.
Because there's no guarantee that all three select boards will be at tomorrow's meeting. It's a Skims meeting that we're happy to be hosting. Right. My only thought on this is that we are 1 month away from town meeting. And when do we need to sign our warrants?
You're going to sign the warrant on this. Well, you're going to choose a date tonight, 11th, 12th, or 13th for
right.
the next meeting.
Right. And that's the night. So that means that we need to find time for a three town select board meeting sometime between now and our next meeting. Otherwise, what you just proposed doesn't work.
It's going to be within the next 2 weeks.
No, that's not true.
No.
This, what we're suggesting is that the three boards get to get. No, there won't be any article on our town meetings related to the IMA other than authorizing the boards to make amendments related to housing.
Oh, okay. All right.
So.
And that would alter the IMA, obviously.
That would alter the IMA.
Right.
IMA. Right.
Right. That's sort of my point. I mean, I wonder whether it makes more sense, just so everyone's on the same page, we know everybody's on the same page, to try to schedule that meeting prior to the signing of the warrant, so that we put the warrant question or article through council and all that kind of stuff.
It's a really simple article. It won't really need council.
Okay, I'm just.
But can't we do that anyway and then finalize this agreement? Because all you're asking for is town meeting to approve changes to this agreement.
And the other thing
related to housing, though.
Only related to housing.
But to that point, I guess if the three towns see the three select boards on the same page with all this stuff, it increases the likelihood that the article will pass all three towns, just because they see the select board members from each of the three towns working closely together, because they know that doing this is in the best interest of all three towns, not just each town in their individual silo.
So you would prefer to have a three town meeting next week?
I would. I realize that the challenge is inherent in that.
Okay. I'll ask the other town administrators if they can pull their...
But we're just asking to agree to change the language on housing. We're not agreeing to any location or any study or
right.
anything else.
It's just changing that the select boards can change the location rather than having to go to town meeting for it.
So can't anybody write that change in here and send it to the other two towns and say, is this...
These amendments on here, you guys can do now as select boards, the three select boards.
Right.
The only changes you can't make that need town meeting approval are related to housing and adding another town.
Okay.
So we were suggesting that you guys approve these amendments at a three town meeting, and then when town meeting comes, approve that final authorized select boards to approve.
And the article would say it's recommended by the select board
right.
for the town meeting members
so
to consider.
99% of the work would be done going into town meeting.
Right.
So I just think we should, I think it's smarter politics to show united front. If we can pull it off. And again, I get
you know, all three town select boards may be in this room tomorrow night, so yeah. maybe we can nail it down and get them.
Could we make that vote even if it's not, is the agenda sufficient for such a vote?
Well, you're all posted select boards.
I understand that, but does the topic need to have been on the agenda?
We're just discussing a date. It's not.
We're not discussing
the agenda. Oh, I see. Discussing. I'm sorry. I thought you were recommending. Okay.
No. I'm sorry. I didn't understand what you were saying. All I'm talking about is date.
Okay.
Since you're all going to potentially be in this room tomorrow night, that might be a good opportunity to.
Can't we decide on it? If tomorrow's.
It's not on the agenda.
Odds are pretty good that one of the other two towns are going to have a meeting next week. They've been meeting pretty regularly.
Right. They're on a forced march.
Tomorrow night's really not the venue for this anyway.
Tomorrow night is a demonstration of how effective SCIMS has been. I mean, sort of to mirror what Jim said about the police department's thoughts on SCIMS. You know, if it's time to sort of drill into people's head that don't want to pay attention, SCIMS seems to be one of the best things we've done for a number of years in these three towns.
Will the reporter be here tomorrow?
Okay. Reporter and AFCAD have been invited.
Okay. What's next?
Cell tower. We did receive one bid that was almost entirely responsive. There were three conditions in that bid that they could not be responsive to. One of them, and this, I'm just going to give you a brief rundown. I'm going to come back for a more in-depth conversation. I'm just still working with our attorney now, but just to give you an update. The three items were town equipment on the cell tower. Apparently the last RFP required that they allow for town equipment, a repeater or something like that up on that tower. They're saying that they want that out of there. There is no, as far as I know, and I think Keith and Jim both said the same thing, we don't have any equipment on the cell tower now. The only reason that was even in the RFP was because of the carryover from the 1990 RFP.
And they have no need, they're not nervous about not having the ability should they need it down the road?
Well, at one point, there was some possibility of the Franklin County fire, the FERCOG's radio system to have a repeater there.
Okay.
And they chose to go to Toby Tower, and I don't know what the other options were, but so there's no...
But you don't foresee any need in the future?
The reason they're opposed to it is because if they exceed the tower that's there, if they give us a blank check,
it limits
what they can do, and then it would be on their dime to put a new tower up to accommodate our equipment. So, and they're saying basically, we're going to give you $1.2 to $1.6 million, we're not also going to put up a new tower for your equipment, which is fair.
Okay.
The second condition is that they would like to see a standard cell easement agreement. specific to the telecommunications industry. We put a generic one in there, which they didn't like. We asked them to provide one to us, but nobody wanted to provide one, so we had to put a generic version in. It's, as far as I'm concerned, it's a non-issue.
Okay.
The third item is the last RFP also called for sharing of financial information. They would like that removed. It made sense in the last RFP because we are, our revenue from them was based on their revenue. We were getting
a percentage,
right. In this new RFP, they're giving us a lump sum, so we really have no financial interest in whether they're doing well or not at that point. And okay, they would like to have that out of there. So again, I don't think any of these three items are really game changers. I think we can work through all of them.
So. What about the easement? Was there a question on the easement for that one time?
An easement?
Or the property that it sits on, the deed or whatever?
You mean that it crosses over into
right.
another? They have a lease with the abutter for that little triangle where it crosses over into the
that's
solar
their property. Of no.
That's a private
right.
deal with them. We have nothing to do with that. So. It was an issue at one point, but they've resolved it themselves.
Okay.
Finally here on my updates, I just want to remind everyone that tomorrow night at 7 p.m. in this room is the SCAMS public information session. The Board of Oversight will be present. They're going to do a slideshow PowerPoint to talk about housing, talk about the last 2 years, their achievements, things like that. So they're taking the lead on.
And they're aware of what their agenda is.
Yep. I spoke to Doug today. I also spoke to Zach today. It sounds like we're all on the same page.
And have they communicated with their board?
Yes.
So the board's aware of what their
yep.
goals are.
Zach said he hasn't heard anything back from the board as far as whether they want to add any more to his PowerPoint, but.
But they're not expecting us, and we'll convene the meeting and then we're gonna throw it to SCAMS.
Yeah.
We have to because it's our town and we're all three here.
Right.
But they're not expecting us anything from us on this.
No, I'll come prepared to, the only thing that we need to be prepared for is to discuss what we are offering SCAMS. And that's all summarized on that bullet point sheet that we have.
And we've already
gone
thousands of times already.
Right. I'll bring copies again for anyone that wants it, but
okay.
You guys have made your offer very clear. It's in writing.
And SCAMS has made their pleasure with our offer very clear as well.
Right.
So
I
as has the town of Sunderland, I think. There's somebody missing. I can't for the life of me think about who it is.
I will
well,
be prepared tomorrow night with those sheets.
Okay.
2016 Hampshire Franklin Municipal Conference. You said you can't go. Are you interested in going or not? Just so we can get you registered.
Fine.
Okay. It's at GCC on Saturday the 9th.
Oh, it's at GCC. It's not at.
No.
It's
okay.
not
in West Springfield.
Did we confirm live broadcast?
Tomorrow night? Yeah.
Live broadcast?
Yep. On two channels?
Okay. You up for that, Joe?
No. What else?
That's all I have for updates.
All right. Well, new business then. Let's put the next meeting date down at the bottom. Grange Ag Day letter of support signature.
Whately has asked for us to write a letter of support for their.
Thanks, you guys.
For their Ag Day on Saturday, April 23rd, it's going to be at the Whately Elementary School, so I've drafted it. It's very simple, and I'll mail it out tomorrow, assuming you sign it tonight.
Yeah, I mean, it's great. It's a great idea.
I think quite a bit of support, and
yeah.
I'm sure they'll get a good turnout.
They're doing some very cool stuff.
Moving on here, personnel policy, contractor services. We have a proposed work plan from UMass for the salary survey that was requested by the personnel committee. This involves conducting a salary survey, a review of our policies, recommending new policies or, you know, amended policies, I guess, for us to adopt. They will put together draft findings and a report, and they'll also come and do a presentation here to the select board or personnel committee, or hopefully both.
Okay.
I'd like to, and the cost is $4,500. It's within the money we've budgeted from the article, and I'd like to ask that you guys allow me to sign a contract with them when they provide them, so we can get that process.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Before you keep going, I'm looking at the agenda here, and I don't want to keep, just Keith and Adelia here longer than they, I mean, I'm sure that you're here because you want to listen.
Of course. No, I just, the only thing I have is, I wanted to give you a quick update, but also Mark has some Chapter 90 project requests that need to be signed and all.
All right, let's do that now so that
I can go over that real quick, or you can take Scott's here for an appointment too, right?
Yeah, I know, but you've been sitting here a long time.
All right, well, I don't have a lot. Can be. The Chapter 90 project request, that is a project request for crack sealing section of River Road from Christian Lane to Straits Road that was paved about 5 years ago and is in need of crack sealing. We'll do usually do one round of crack sealing, and usually by the time that fails again, it's time for doing a repaving again. So this is and also in there is the section on that we paved about the exact same time frame on South Long Plain Road from Straits Road down towards where the old dump used to be. And that's all those, that paperwork is just project request for Chapter 90 for that, those projects.
Will that pretty much exhaust our Chapter 90?
Oh gosh, no.
Really?
This is small.
This is crack sealing over what you've already resurfaced?
Correct, this is just crack sealing to seal the cracks that are present in the blacktop. It was paved with, you know, about 5 years ago. This is a section south of Christian Lane.
Okay, and that's the
more recently, in the last 2 years, or going on 2 and 3 years ago, two years ago and a year ago, is we paved basically everything on River Road from Christian Lane all the way to the Deerfield Town Line.
Right.
That has nothing to do with that section. This is south, going down by Helstowski's and all the way down to right. Straits Road. If you look at that section, it's getting to the point where, you know, almost should have been crack sealed by now.
And who's doing this work? Your
contract.
Your contract?
Yeah, that's part of the Franklin Regional Council of Governments, our co-op, our county bids. The company, you know, so the way the county bids work is all the towns put all of our crack sealing together, combine it, and get more volume, get volume discounts, so that when the crack sealing company will come to Whately, they'll more like that. When they schedule it, I'm sure they will be doing multiple towns at the time, so that they make it more efficient and more feasible. And that's where the savings comes in.
Right. How long does this typically last when you do crack sealing?
Again, that will probably, it'll take us to the point of needing to be repaved again. So probably another close to 10 years before I.
Okay, you have to sign in charge of this?
Yep, there's a lot of signatures. So unfortunately, it's MassDOT's.
What else?
The other thing that I just wanted to update you on, and I know Mark's working on it, is just so you know where things are at, is the Egypt Road project. We're sort of, right now waiting to finalize the purchase of the property. I don't know if you found any more on that as far as probate,
The attorney's working on it now. It did not go to probate.
Okay.
My understanding is the property was left to
the wife.
His wife. And she's alive and willing to sell the property and be there to sign that quote.
Just so you don't, in case you didn't know, the property was in a deceased person's name, so they're having to work through that. And so at the present, for me to move forward, not only does MassDOT want this finalized, the Franklin Council of Governments wants it finalized, so we're working on that.
We may have to bump it from the April meeting to the May meeting.
To May, probably, yeah. Okay.
I don't think I can prove to
Right, I know, but that's, just to update you that, where that's at.
I'll just do this here.
There's one form where you just have to put it underneath. Don't ask me why they do
yeah,
it.
The, yeah, oh. I got it. What are you doing? I don't think it's all three here, I think it's just one.
Oh, just one, oh, okay.
There's just one there?
Just put two in there.
Oh, two in there?
I have to go under, yeah. That's just the way they do it.
Okay. So what were you saying, Keith?
So that's just where an update on where the Egypt Road stands. Once we get the purchase finalized, then we can take the next step forward there. Also,
the second project can take once you break ground.
Well, one of the things that is being included at the, you know, I've had discussion with the water commissioners. They want to see that the water main gets extended while we're doing the intersection work. We're going to do the water main at the same time, so that'll get taken care of. So that once the pavement gets done, there'll be no need to go in and disrupt it in the future.
Okay.
So to answer your question, I would say realistically a few weeks worth of work. It's not a big project.
Okay.
How far is the water main going to be extended?
It's going to, the water commissioners want it about 100 feet shy of the railroad tracks. So I guess it's about, Wayne's already gone. Wayne had to, somewhere around probably 400 to 500 feet of water main put in.
That's on the south side of the road?
Correct. It'll end up on the south side, but where it starts and comes across 5 and 10, it'll actually be in the under the pavement of the road. So but then work its way over. We're having to, you know, trying to deal with the bends and the way the engineer laid it out to avoid having to put bends in. Each pipe you can deflect a certain amount of angle. And so the engineers laid it out to be the best possible way, so.
But you have to trench under flat root 5 and stay
we'll open cut it.
Open cut what?
That's where we're working at right now with MassDOT. It'll most likely be open cut.
If they don't allow open cut?
Yeah. Based on the 8 right now, we're at the point where it's a good time to do it because of the condition. I don't know if you've been down that way recently, but you'll just open cut Route 5 about a half a mile south of it. So if it was any situation where the pavement was in the more recent being paved, no, they wouldn't allow us. And that's why this is a good time to do it, because if the water commissioners wait until they, a few more years down the road to the point where MassDOT goes through and paves it, then no, you won't. They won't allow you to cut it or get in there unless it's emergency work. And they can't, that wouldn't be, wouldn't fall under the criteria of emergency work. So, the other thing that I wanted to just update you a little bit, I did make mention of this project now that this MassDOT has that offers money to bridges under 20-foot spans. And as I mentioned before, the bridges that we have out on Williamsburg are in that category. The scenario is I had a representative from MassDOT come and talk to me about this, wanting to make sure that the towns take advantage of it, have an inventory of what structures they have in town that meet the criteria. And as I told them, I feel we're already on top of that and know what we have. But I wanted to point out, and if any of you guys were attending like the Stan Rosenberg
thing on April 9th, that might be a good time just to also, you know, campaign for the fact that the town of Whately has bridges that are in need of a permanent replacement that fall under this brand new program that the governor has come up with. I have talked to Mass DOT in my conversations with Mass DOT. There's some things that aren't, you know, it hasn't even been technically voted by legislation yet. It's been presented by the governor, but it hasn't been voted by the legislation. But they feel that it will. That's going to happen. So once this does happen, it's $500,000 per town per year is all that you can spend, you're allowed. It's going to be very competitive. So it's going to be another one of those things where I feel that the squeaky wheel gets the grease type thing that it's, I'm sure there's going to be a lot of politics in it.
Does it matter
as to who gets it?
Does it matter what functional class it's on, whether it's local or
I minor? I do not believe so, but I'm not positive. I don't know if there'll be any criteria in how they rate which bridges or which structures get the money.
Yeah.
That's a possibility. Those are things that are unknown to me at this point in time, whether that. One of the things that the Mass DOT said to me is that the one thing that we definitely had going for us at the moment is we have one that's closed. The fact that it's closed now is, in their mind, will put us higher on the list. But again, it's something that I just wanted to continue to push for.
Do you have a permit you can send me on this? Do you have anything in writing you can send me?
Yeah.
Okay.
All ours would be on the local roads?
Correct.
Possible ones under 20 feet.
Correct.
Yep. Okay.
So that's primarily all I wanted to bring forth tonight.
Where do you stand on the electrical work?
I have yet to set up. I want to do more of a. When I had first gotten an estimate, it was only through one, and you know, to make it competitive enough, I gotta go out. I've gotta more or less write up a. Like a proposal, ask for proposals. So I have not had that opportunity yet, but that'll be coming forth fairly soon.
Bajillia, did you have anything, or should we go? You're just here to give Keith moral support for the public presentation skills.
Okay. I'm showing him how to drive.
Okay, well, again, you still making syrup, or is that not
the mother's job is never truly done.
Sugar is
over. Yeah. Okay.
Okay, Scott.
All right, thank you.
Evening.
Hi.
Hi. So, you want me to just explain it, or you want to ask questions?
Oh, just a thumbnail summary of the program and why.
Yeah, so U.S. Forest Service has a program to protect forest land from development, and it's called Forest Legacy Program.
Thanks.
And it makes funding available to the states for the purpose of protecting forest land. So in order to be eligible for this funding, states have to establish forest legacy areas. And once an area is established, then the money is available to do land deals with willing landowners. So there's a proposed forest legacy area for western Massachusetts, west of the river, that includes Whately. And the request has been for the town to send a letter of support for the designation of this forest legacy area. I believe it will cover pretty much all forest land within the town. It's possible that it might focus more on the western part, but I don't know exactly what the boundary is for this. It has no obligation for landowners or for the town. So the town is not obligated to do anything. Landowners are not obligated to do anything. It doesn't cost the town anything, nor does it cost landowners anything. All it does is open up possibilities for the landowners. So if a landowner wanted to protect their land, but was not able to donate their land, and wanted to have some compensation for a conservation restriction or to sell it in fee, there might not be other options available for them. But this designation would give them an option to work with a land trust and apply for forest legacy money in order to get compensated for putting their land in conservation.
So essentially it's an APR for forest lands.
Yeah.
How are landowners in town going to know about this?
Well, I think that the land trusts are primarily the ones that put together these deals. So it could be the town. Some town have open space committees that have proactive land conservation, and they would sort of notify landowners. Often land trusts will look for areas where they might want to operate, or they might decide to partner with, say, the snowmobile club and say, are there critical pieces of land that if it were sold, your whole network would be disrupted? So there's a lot of different ways that word could get out. There's not a set way that it happens.
Well, how's it happening here in Whately?
It's a good question.
It was in the paper. It was a whole article in the paper with maps.
Yeah. Well, but it's no different than how does a farmer, a person who owns a big swath of ag land, find out about APR? I mean, APR is common knowledge, and I got to believe that as this becomes more prevalent, it will also become common knowledge among landowners of forested areas.
But APR is kind of tied to, well, assessments, it affects assessments and all, and deeds, and that's assessors get involved in that as well. Now, who's going to get involved with this? Is it your commission going to get involved with this program, or?
It's unlikely. For small towns like ours, conservation commissions are usually busy trying to administer the Wetlands Protection Act, and that's why there's so many land trusts. And so in our area, we actually have overlap for two land trusts. The Kestrel Land Trust and Franklin Land Trust both operate in Whately. So either one of them would be who I would turn to if the town wanted to try to promote a particular land deal, or if there was a landowner that contacted me and said, I'm really interested in this program, that's who I'd refer them to.
So I guess then there's no town match that's required, like an APR.
Right.
There's nothing like that.
There may be a match required, but usually the land trust orchestrates that.
Are going to cover that, right.
Sometimes they may go to the town through CPA and say, would you be interested in matching for this project?
Just like an APR.
Just like an APR. Or they might go to another grant program that they know. And, you know, both land trusts are very capable. They're staffed land trusts. They have a lot of experience in this, so there's multiple options. But it would be a way of for the CPA money to go further, because you could flip it around and say it's a way for CPA money to leverage federal dollars for priorities that the town might have.
And there's no, you know, some forest land is eminently developable, and other forest land is
backland.
Yeah.
There's
no distinction with this between those two columns.
No, not on its face, but in general, to get approved for funding, you have to make a good case. So the land should be of value.
Okay.
So a small parcel that's surrounded by farmland in East Whately has less likelihood of getting approved for this kind of funding than a parcel that's adjacent to other protected land in West Whately. That sort of expands a big area of protected forest land. But I don't know, you know, that either one of them is by any way sort of out of the running for, you know, like there's nothing that prohibits them from applying. It's just a matter of whether they can compete with other projects.
So they might not get it.
They might not get it.
Okay.
Right.
Can we put this on our website, either on your site, if there's something that we approve this letter of support on your portion on the website?
You're welcome to. I don't have anything to do with our website. We have minimal stuff on
the town. I guess I'd like to see it somewhere that people know.
My only request is that we put it on the new website. We are having serious space issues with it's shutting down our email accounts and everything.
So. And that's going to happen sooner rather than later.
Okay,
it's being built out right now. So.
Wait until then, but I guess I would like to see it somewhere on the website.
Yeah, our new website will have unlimited space, so we can put it on that
Okay. In theory, I'm perfectly fine signing the letter. I do think could be partially because of equity. I mean, if agricultural landowners have the option of protecting their land, then
forest landowners should have that same protection. I personally, I think the town's going to have a conversation at some point about if we protect every parcel of land that's in town, we are going to severely limit our ability to grow as a town. Hmm. And I know there are some people who would be perfectly happy keeping Whately at a 1,450 person town for eternity. That would be a problem with our tax base, ultimately. So at some point, we are going to have a conversation about what do we leave for potential development if somebody wants to develop it, and what do we leave, what don't we?
You because mean another conversation about that?
Another, yeah. Yes.
I've been on master planning committees,
right.
And when you overlay all the different things from water supply to rare species to agricultural land, cultural, historic land, just like nothing left. So
there's nothing
eventually,
left
you
John
have to
the last piece.
There's some,
yeah. I mean, there's no space for commercial development.
Right.
You know, just
so you need to be proactive about where you want to develop, so that you can make the best use of the money that's available for other things. The nibble to death by ducks is the last way we want to go.
Right, it's not, there's no plan.
There's no plan to it,
and
it fragments what would be otherwise valuable or precludes other options. So yeah, I agree with
you.
Nobody is trying to protect everything.
Right.
It's just that if the federal government has an opportunity for Whately West residents to access resources.
Why not?
Oh yeah. We should do what we can to make sure they're eligible to do that.
I'm just using the opportunity to say that we don't have a,
yep.
We really don't have a plan right now.
Yep.
So, I motion to sign the letter.
Okay, second.
Done.
Thank you.
Just a chair. Okay. Get that out.
Okay, thank you.
I appreciate you supporting that.
No, thanks for bringing that to our attention. All right. Green Jag Day, did we do that?
Yeah.
Yep.
Personnel policy, contract for services.
Yep. Did that.
Forest, we just did. Bucket truck.
John, are you here for the signature?
No, I don't have to be, but if you want to do that, that's fine.
It's actually coming up right after this.
Yeah, that's fine.
Shared bucket truck. Sunderland and Deerfield have both signed the agreement.
Just dating back to last year's town meeting, that
yeah.
This is
yeah.
Still.
We're ready to roll now.
Finally, apparently a lot of legal issues.
Quite a lot of flat yeah. Tires along the way.
I did not have our attorney look over this because this was approved by Compliment and Page, a different attorney in Compliment and Page, so I have no issues with it.
Did they pass the bar?
So what's
then we're good.
We're going to get two attorneys to agree on
seven
it.
Or seven?
We appropriated $7,000. Each town would pitch in $7,000. This requires us to pitch in $500 per year and budget for that in our operating budgets. It's in Keith's budget for this year.
Please tell me you don't have to go to town meeting to get that $500 approved.
Well, no
it's
more than
budget.
Any other budget. It's in
right.
The
operating I'm just.
No, 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 no.
It was a very long debate, as you recall,
yeah.
Last April.
This is the original. You can see Sunderland and Deerfield both signed, and there's a location there for you to sign. Well,
I didn't catch how we purchased the truck, or this
no,
is just the
no.
Agreement?
This is just the agreement, so that when we purchased the truck,
off.
Yeah.
Didn't they have a truck in mind, though?
They did, but
that was
a year and a half
right,
ago.
Right, we may have missed the boat.
It's not worth as much.
By the end of my next term, we'll have that truck purchased.
Right. Yeah. I like positive thinking.
The next item here, I need you guys to sign for the release of the easement that was approved at town meeting. This is for John's.
Water.
Yeah.
And where was it? Where is this? This was between two different sections of your.
Yeah, the planning board put that in place when they approved the subdivision in case we didn't follow through on it. They wanted to loop the water at the request of the water department.
Yeah.
So that was an easement to go from the end of phase one across the land to phase two and loop it back out to Long Plain. So that's all been done. So that easement is basically not needed.
So nothing was done in that easement?
Not within the easement, no.
This is the last step. Mary Ellen, if you can notarize that also.
And then we'll need a certified vote thing.
Yeah, we need that.
Thank you. So it's going to go all the way around to the other.
Yeah, it is current, it's worked already. It's all connected.
Okay.
Yeah.
We have a resignation here that I'd like you to accept from Howard Benner from the Historical Commission. Alan McCarl said that they're looking for a replacement now. So I'll come back to you with a nomination as soon as they provide one. Franklin County Solid Waste is requesting that you appoint Quint as the alternate rep for Whately on the district's board.
Who was there before?
I think the current rep might be Ronnie Williams, and she's gone to Arizona for a chunk of the year, so I think that's probably why they're not an alternate rep.
It's fine. Quint's great.
Okay, fine.
Mother's Day half marathon. Fred's running?
Yep.
We have a request to approve again the Mother's Day half marathon. I did ask that they speak to Chief Savini to let him know the date and time and what roads would be affected by that. They've provided a certificate of insurance, and I just need your approval.
Approved from my perspective.
Yeah, fine.
I have a few items, just a couple of unanticipated items. Actually, just one. I already covered one. Haydenville Road. I spoke to Charlene from Williamsburg. She's drafting a letter for her board to sign. This just happened today, so that's why it's anticipated and why I don't have a letter prepared for you to sign tonight. But she's asking her board, at Paul Dunphy's request, to sign a letter to be sent to Kulik's office requesting that we hold a meeting. This is kind of another version of what we've already discussed, but Paul Dunphy has suggested that he feels positive that he can pull a meeting together through Kulik's office if we send a letter requesting that meeting to happen.
So who would attend the meeting? The two select boards, obviously.
The two select boards, probably representatives from the three communities, because Northampton is somewhat involved in this.
Yeah.
Representatives from Kulik's office, and they've asked that we copy Rosenberg's office and request that somebody attend from his office, Downing's office, and any.
Well, wouldn't we also include Kokot's office?
I'll copy any.
Yeah, if Northampton's included, Kokot should. I mean. Yeah.
Where will this be at?
What's that?
Where will it be at?
I offered to host it here.
Yeah, that's fine.
So I'd like to draft a letter, and I'm happy to email it to you. I'd rather not wait until the next meeting.
Why don't you send the letter? Just send the letter.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure you guys were okay with that.
Yeah, that's fine. Go ahead.
All I'm going to do is request a meeting and offer to.
Thanks. Definitely hurt.
An offer to host.
Yeah. All right.
I can't handle that. You're gonna.
Yes, we should. When are we gonna do it? What are we gonna shoot for?
I don't know. I'll have a conversation with Charlene to find out what she's proposing for it.
Let's do it sooner rather than later. I mean, this is about releasing the bond issues, and the end of the fiscal year, we may have a better shot at beginning rather than the beginning of the fiscal year. I mean,
reconvening and keeping the conversation moving, I think, is we can't lose. So that's all I have.
You guys got anything?
No. New date is going
to
be.
Oh, new date. I'm sorry.
Oh yeah, we jumped past that. 12th or 13th? You said.
I'm leaning towards the 11th, but let me just check here.
Do we have to do the 11th because it has to be 14 days before the annual meeting?
Let's
approve the warrant.
Pretty fair point, Frank.
You have to approve the warrant,
annual
right?
Annual town meeting is 7.
Oh, it's 7.
Right.
It's the 20th. Oh, it's only 7 days?
For annual.
Before? Oh, okay.
I would prefer it to be 11th.
Okay, 11th's fine. Same time, 11th, okay.
Okay. 7.
7.
Is that okay for you, Jonathan?
Yeah.
Okay. And then on the 26th annual town meeting, we're meeting as well, the select board?
We should meet at 6:30, shouldn't we?
What, is that before? That's the other thing. Is that 6:30 we need, or is that
right? Yeah,
well, I think it will probably, usually depends on what the agenda looks like.
Right.
If need be, we'll meet at 6:30 and have a brief meeting.
Very, very short.
If, just in case anything comes up.
And we're doing it. We're doing it at the gym.
At the gym. And Mary Ellen already made that reservation.
Yeah. That's what I heard through the grapevine. Okay. Are you guys all set for the 11th?
Sure.
Motion to adjourn.
Okay, second.
Good night and good luck.